So Rodolfo Dirzo. I'm Pierre-Michel Forget. I'm a researcher at the National Museum of Natural History. And I'm very glad to interview here, to be here to interview you.
Thank you.
Because I know you for many years.
Thank you.
But there's some hidden place in your bio I didn't know.
Okay.
Can you tell me, how did you move from snails, invertebrates, to vertebrates? How did it happen, and when did it happen?
Okay, that's a wonderful question, Pierre-Michel. Thank you for starting with that. So, slugs and snails, gastropods, that was the mega herbivores that I studied for my PhD thesis at the University of North Wales in Bangor with a famous professor of the time, John Harper, who was you know, very prominent figure in the development of the field of plant ecology and plant evolutionary ecology. And I was always interested in the interactions between plants and animals. And at the time, which is almost back in the Pleistocene, right? Many, many, many decades ago, I was looking for a place in which I could do my graduate studies, master's and PhD, looking at the ecology and evolutionary ecology of the interactions between plants and animals. And because that professor, John Harper, was so prominent in the field of ecology, and I wanted to do that from the perspective of the plants, not so much from the zoocentric view, but from the phytocentric perspective. So that was kind of the obvious place for me to go. So I wrote to him, you know, at the time, and I asked him, Professor Harper, would you be interested in taking a student who is interested in the evolutionary ecology of plant-animal interactions? He said, yes, come along. So I got a grant from the British Council at the time. It was not so easy to find PhD or master's programs in Mexico or in Latin America at large at the time. So I got a grant from the British Council and went to initially do my master's with John. And I began working on this interaction between plants and slugs and snails. And the master was a relatively short project, but I actually extended it a little bit, and then John suggested, why don't you stay on for the PhD and expand, you know, what you have started to a larger project. And at the time, there was this idea that the white clover, that famous plant, Trifolium repens, which was known to be cyanogenic, to have the capacity of releasing hydrogen cyanide, the predominant hypothesis at the time was that it had some variation in the proportion of phenotypes or genotypes that were cyanogenic, depending on climatic variables, on temperature, winter temperature. And there were some interesting reports that suggested that perhaps animals would be the responsible agents for the evolution of those traits, cyanogenesis in a plant. Who would have imagined that an innocent plant such as a white clover would be cyanogenic, would have the capacity to release hydrogen cyanide? So I decided to look at the interaction of those clovers with slugs and snails, which were the important herbivores, are the important herbivores where the plant is occurring. So my life began really pretty much, as you said, looking at the evolutionary ecology of plant-animal interactions, with the plants not being a tropical rainforest, being a very simplified grassland with clover, and the animals not being elephants or tapirs or peccaries, but being slugs and snails. But it was wonderful because they were very easy to manipulate and I was able to do a lot of things in such a short period of a master's and a PhD.
When did you observe that herbivores were important for the maintenance of biodiversity in tropical forests, especially in Mexico, in Los Tuxtlas?
Yeah, so it turns out that due to a number of historical reasons, I was appointed to be the director of the Los Tuxtlas Research Station. That's in the mid to late 80s, when I was a young man. And, you know, living there, being physically present in the field station for, you know, week after week, day and night, actually living physically there, I began to notice some very interesting patterns. For example, I had been studying herbivory pretty much as a legacy of what I had done in my PhD with slugs and snails and clover plants, and I was measuring rates of herbivory. So, well, there was something that really was very intriguing. The amount of herbivory damage that I was finding in my plants, I had permanent plots, very much a herbarian approach to doing ecology, I was not detecting any vertebrate damage in my plants. So that was one thing. The other thing that was really very striking is Los Tuxtlas has these amazing seedling carpets. you know, dominated by a few species in a patch, another species in another patch. And I began to think maybe this is not quite so normal. I mean, the fact that I don't see any vertebrate damage at all, and the fact that some plants dominate locally in the physical space in patches. So that was kind of the biological observation. But at the same time, the fact that I was living there, and sometimes I could hear the shotguns, for example, or sometimes I actually run into people, you know, with some peccaries on their backs and things like that, I began to make a connection in terms of, is it possible that, you know, these human impacts on the mammalian fauna of this place relates to the fact that I don't see any evidence of mammalian herbivory on those plants. So that was one component. And another one, which is really very Costa Rican and very much Costa Rican oriented, is the fact that Dan Jansen had to do this study on the Corcovado National Park to look at the impact of gold mining. And he invited me to be part of the team. And in that team, we discovered that one of the most prevalent activities of these gold miners was the hunting. And so we began to take take data and evidence, you know, very quick evidence in terms of, for example, fruits that would be lying on the ground without being consumed, seedling carpets and things like that. So all of those things combined made me think that maybe there was a connection between those patterns of herbivory that I was detecting in the understory of Los Tuxtlas with the fact that animals were not very evident. And of course, one is always, you know, deceived by the fact that you don't see the animals because they're very secretive, many of them are nocturnal. So it was not very clear to me until I then began to actually test the hypothesis. To what extent is this a sort of a human impact that is driving these patterns of herbivory? The way to approach that at the time was to go and find another tropical rainforest area in which I could have certainty that the mammalian composition, that the mammalian fauna would be in good shape. That took a long time for me to find a place to compare Los Tuxtlas with, right? Los Tuxtlas, I was imagining that would be the defaunated site, and I was going looking for another place that would be the place to compare it with. It took a long time, but eventually I found an amazing site in the southeast of the country, close to the border with Guatemala. It's a place called Montes Azules, a fantastic biological preserve, biosphere reserve, still present in Mexico, in fantastic shape. So I decided to have my student at the time, Alvaro Miranda, hence the papers Dirzo and Miranda, when we started to compare the two sites, and then we began to see, you know, for me being a person used to a place such as Los Tuxtlas, coming to this place where tapirs, peccaries, deer, and everything was so common in normal abundances, and began to see the types of damage that I was missing in that other place, that was a kind of an eye-opener that sort of directed me to really consider that the absence of the big animals can have a tremendous impact on the structure and diversity of the forest understory.
That is a study you published in the frugivores meeting from the 1985 meeting in Los Tuxtlas. That was a paper Dirzo in Miranda.
Right.
And I was just starting my studies myself. And I've been really impressed by that work.
Yeah.
And so now we are 25 years later. So throughout all those decades, what are the changes in Los Tuxtlas?
Yeah. So most unfortunately, human encroachment has been going on in that area. In about the mid-90s, I published another study looking at the deforestation rates. And that was also motivated by my work on defaunation, because I wanted to see what is happening to the habitat as a whole. Because, you know, it's easy for people to imagine that it's not only the actual direct impact of humans in terms of the hunting and removal of animals for illegal trading or whatever, but it was also the changes in the habitat that I was suspecting were driving the populations to a lower levels that I was detecting at Los Tuxtlas. So I did this study on deforestation in Los Tuxtlas. I was able to collect aerial photographs of the 80s, then satellite images of the 90s and beyond, and then I began to see the tremendous changes in the forest coverage in that area. By the time I published those papers, the rates of deforestation at Los Tuxtlas were 4.2% per year, which is a gigantic deforestation rate. And so, being director of the field station and then having published those papers and then looking at the sort of the modifications of the herbivory patterns made me sort of forced me to continue monitoring the situation in Los Tuxtlas. And then with the, you know, with the proliferation of satellite imagery and tools, I was able to monitor the changes in the field station. And unfortunately, for a number of years, the situation continued to be really, really bad. Actually, we've come to the situation in which the actual field station, which belongs to the National University of Mexico, is only 650 hectares, but is naturally connected to a volcano, which is a sort of adjacent to the field station. Well, we've come to the point, Pierre-Michel, basically, in which what we have left now is the field station, a little corridor that connects to the volcano, which has been declared another protected area, but the rest is pretty much impacted by humans. So that is also relevant from the point of view, you know, of restoration. If we were to think, for example, about the possibility of refaunating Los Tuxtlas, to bring back the tapirs, peccaries, and so on and so forth, one of the things we will have to do is to work on the habitat to make sure that the habitat is going to be able to maintain viable populations of these. And the other critical issue, to work with the local communities, to engage them, to make them sort of embrace the project, and to have really the local communities being part of the conservation programs in that area. But so far the situation has been really very difficult. If you measure the rates of deforestation nowadays, the rates of deforestation have declined significantly, and the amount of forest being lost is very low now. But that is kind of a deceiving situation, because that means to some extent that what is left to be deforested now is almost zero. So what you have is the protected areas, or the areas that are very inaccessible, and that's why the deforestation rates are very low. But definitely the area has been very, very much impacted since then, up until now.
So after this long period of studies, this discipline of focus on the impact of hunting is quite widespread now in all the continents.
Yes.
And we start to discover that your findings can be generalized to many other areas.
Yes.
And so recently, following last meeting we had in Brazil, you edited this special volume on
defaunation.
On defaunation, and on the effect of defaunation on terrestrial tropical ecosystem.
Yeah.
And you edited that with Mauro Galletti.
With Mauro Galletti, yeah.
So that's like an intermediate point in science. What to you is the next step? What can we say to the younger generation? What to you, what are the most important studies to carry on in the next decades?
Okay. So I think the next phase, and you're very right, in the last ATBC meeting, we convened a symposium in which we brought many scientists to talk about this issue, and then we asked them and some other colleagues to produce papers and to put together papers, and now we have a special issue coming out soon, which basically is trying to look at where are we now in the state of development of this field. And I think the field is growing very actively. It's very active and is having many different ramifications. One aspect, for example, is the genetic consequences of defaunation. Another one is, for example, and this is one that I am particularly interested in, which is what does that mean in terms of the ecosystem services that people should be concerned about? And we'll talk about that in a minute. The other one is that I am really convinced that we need to convey to the general public that this question of animal loss, that thing that I call defaunation, is really a significant, I would say it's another major global environmental change. Our communities in many tropical ecosystems are being changed so dramatically that, you know, the students of the future, if they don't know these historical facts, they might go and study their ecosystems without them knowing that probably their research is going to be tweaked, if not biased, by this absence of these animals in the forest ecosystem. So sort of the, you know, conveying to the public the socialization of this, the significance of this phenomenon and the magnitude of this phenomenon globally is one thing that I think we need to work with. The other one that I am particularly interested is the significance in terms of what is now called ecosystem services. And it's easy to imagine, for example, that if you talk about pollinators, it's obvious that they have a very important ecosystem service because many of our crops are pollinated by wild animals. But if you think about peccaries and jaguars and tapirs and so on, it doesn't come so close to our minds as to what would be the significance or the consequences of not having these organisms in natural ecosystems. And so we make a jump, a big jump now, and we move to Africa, which is where I am now studying the consequences of defaunation in terms of risks of human disease. So basically what is happening is that many of our natural ecosystems are being impacted by human activities, and the big animals are being lost dramatically. But at the same time, we're seeing a proliferation of the small rodents, the rats, mice, chipmunks, those kinds of things are proliferating because obviously they're not hunted out, they're not susceptible to reductions in the habitat and so on. So we're seeing these very unbalanced communities nowadays globally, right? With the loss of the big animals and proliferation of the small little guys. And that brings about a number of important ecological consequences, and also, I think, important situations for human beings. For example, the proliferation of rodents, or the proliferation of rats, might bring about high risks of disease, for example, if these rodents are carrying vectors of pathogens, which might be relevant for human communities. And that's exactly what we're trying to do and understand in the African savannas nowadays.
Have a last question.
Sure.
So you move from invertebrate, herbivore, small one, then you can even breed in boxes.
Yes.
And then you move now to other big animals, megafauna. And what is your favorite seed disperser in Los Tuxtlas?
My favorite seed disperser in Los Tuxtlas, well, you got to remember that, you know, when I came into Los Tuxtlas, the place was already defaunated, so we had lost many of the really, really fabulous seed dispersal agents. I think it would have been, for me, the tapir and the peccaries, but unfortunately, they were not present then. It was not until I went to other places, like in Amazonia or Central America, here, that I began to understand and see the significance of those animals, that I went back, now, not to Los Tuxtlas, but to Montes Azules, where I have my site for comparison, and there we have tapirs and peccaries, and particularly tapirs are really, really my favorites. Amazing animals, really wonderful creatures, roaming around the forest, and, you know, doing herbivory, consuming plant tissue, but also impacting the vegetation in terms of the trampling, the physical effects, the deposition of defecations, for example, which is critical, but also those depositions bring about the movement of seeds of many different species. Secondarily, because many of them collect the seeds that have been already dispersed and they move into different locations. So I think the meso and megafauna of the neotropics would be my favorite animals, to consider them as factors that move and maintain the dispersal and diversity of many plant species in the tropics.
Thank you.
My pleasure. My pleasure.